After James Henry Trotter had been living with his two cruel aunts for 3 miserable years, something rather peculiar happened to him. A mysterious old man gave him a bag of glittering magic, which, unfortunately, James dropped beside a withered old peach tree. A peach grew on the peach tree. What's so peculiar about that? Well, it grew to be the size of a house. And one night, James, after his awful aunts had locked him out of the house, found a tunnel in the giant peach, which he crawled along until he came to the stone in the very center of the fruit. He noticed a small door cut into the face of the peach stone. He went in and was shocked to hear a voice say, "Look who's here." And another one said, "We've been waiting for you." James's frightened eyes traveled round the room in the peach stone. There was an old green grasshopper as large as a dog sitting directly across the room from him. And next to the old green grasshopper, there was an enormous spider. And next to the spider was a giant ladybird with 9 black spots on her scarlet shell. Each of these 3 was squatting upon a magnificent chair. On a sofa nearby, reclining comfortably in curled up positions, there was a centipede and an earthworm, and on the floor over in the far corner, there was something thick and white that looked as though it might be a silkworm, but it was sleeping soundly and nobody was paying any attention to it. Every one of these creatures was at least as big as James himself, and in the strange greenish light that shone down from somewhere in the ceiling, they were absolutely terrifying to behold.
"You mustn't be frightened," the ladybird said kindly. "We wouldn't dream of hurting you."
"James," the centipede said. "Your name is James, isn't it?"
"Yes."
"Well, James, have you ever in your life seen such a marvelous, colossal centipede as me?"
"I certainly haven't," said James. "How on earth did you get to be like that?"
"Very peculiar," the centipede said. "Very, very peculiar indeed. Let me tell you what happened. I was messing about in the garden under the old peach tree, and suddenly a funny little green thing came wriggling past my nose. Bright green it was, and extraordinarily beautiful."
"Oh, but I know what that was," cried James.
"It happened to me too," said the ladybird.
"And me,"
Miss Spider said.
"I actually swallowed one,"
the earthworm declared proudly.
"So did I,"
the ladybird said.
"I swallowed 3,
the centipede cried.
"Would you be kind enough, Miss Spider, to make the beds?"
A few minutes later, Miss Spider had made the first bed. It was hanging from the ceiling like a hammock, but the stuff that it was made of shimmered like silk in the pale light.
"I do hope you'll find it comfortable,"
Miss Spider said to the old green grasshopper. Then she spun the next hammock and the ladybird got into it. After that, she spun a large one for the centipede and an even longer one for the earthworm.
"And how do you like your bed?"
she said to James when it came to his turn.
"Hard or soft?"
"I like it soft, thank you very much," James answered. And oh, how soft and comfortable it was compared with the hard, bare boards that his aunts had always made him sleep upon at home. Already, he was beginning to like his new friends very much.
"Good night, old green grasshopper," he whispered. "Good night, ladybird. Good night, Miss Spider."
But before he could go through them all, he had fallen asleep.
"We're off," someone was shouting. "We're off at last."
James woke up with a jump and looked around him. The creatures were all out of their hammocks and moving excitedly round the room. Suddenly the floor gave a great heave as though an earthquake was taking place.
"Here we go,"
shouted the old green grasshopper, hopping up and down with excitement.
"Hold on tight."
"What's happening?" cried James, leaping out of his hammock. "What's going on?" The ladybird, who was obviously a kind and gentle creature, came over and stood beside him.
"In case you don't know it," she said,
"we are
about to depart forever from the top of this ghastly hill. At this moment, our centipede, who has a pair of jaws as sharp as razors, is up there on top of the peach, nibbling away at the stem."
Just then, the centipede stuck his grinning face through a hole in the ceiling and shouted,
"I've done it, we're off!"
We're off, the others cried. We're off. Outside in the garden at that very moment, Aunt Sponge and Aunt Spiker had just taken their places at the front gate as the first stream of early morning sightseers was visible in the distance, climbing up the hill to view the peach.
We shall make a fortune today, Aunt Spiker was saying. Just look at all these people.
Good gracious me, what's that awful noise?
Both women swung round to look. The noise, of course, had been caused by the giant peach rolling across the garden towards the place where Aunt Sponge and Aunt Spiker were standing. They gaped, they screamed, they started to run, they panicked. They both got in each other's way. They began pushing and jostling, and each one of them was thinking only about saving herself. Then there was a crunch, and then there was silence. The peach rolled on, and behind it, Aunt Sponge and Aunt Spiker lay ironed out upon the grass, as flat and thin and lifeless as a couple of paper dolls cut out of a picture book. Faster and faster the peach went, and the crowds of people screamed and scattered right and left as it went hurtling by. At the bottom of the hill, it charged across the road. Then it rushed across about 20 fields, breaking down all the fences and hedges in its path. The land sloped downhill all the way until it reached the ocean. The peach was rushing closer and closer to the towering white cliffs, and when it reached the edge, it began to fall down, 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 smack. It hit the water with a colossal splash and sank like a stone. But a few seconds later, up it came again, and this time it stayed up, floating serenely upon the surface of the water. At this moment, the scene inside the peach itself was one of indescribable chaos. James was lying on the floor amongst a tangled mass of centipede and earthworm and spider and ladybird and glowworm and old green grasshopper. In the whole history of the world, no travellers had ever had a more terrible journey than those unfortunate creatures. Oh, it was a frantic and terrible trip. But it was all over now, and everybody was beginning slowly and painfully to disentangle himself from everybody else.
Pardon me, murmured the ladybird, turning a trifle pale, but am I wrong in thinking we seem to be bobbing up and down?
You're still giddy from the journey, the old green grasshopper told her. Is everybody ready to go upstairs now and take a look around?
Yes, yes, they shouted. Come on, let's go. Miss Spider set about weaving a long rope ladder that would reach from the floor up to the ceiling. So half an hour later, the whole company climbed up the ladder one by one and disappeared into a dark, soggy tunnel in the ceiling that went steeply upward. A minute later, they were out in the open, standing on the very top of the beach. Everybody looked around in amazement.
We're in the middle of the sea, cried James.
And indeed they were. A strong current and high wind had carried the beach so quickly away from the shore that already the land was out of sight.
I can't swim, cried the ladybird.
But you won't have to swim, said James calmly. We're floating beautifully.
The boy is quite right, the old green grasshopper said. Everything will be all right in the end.
Why, absolute nonsense, cried the earthworm. If we're not going to be drowned, then every one of us is going to starve to death instead.
James took a deep breath. Can't you realize, he said patiently, that we have enough food here to last for weeks and weeks?
Where, they all said, where?
Why, the peach, of course. You can eat all you want. It would take us weeks and weeks to make any sort of dent in this enormous peach. They all went over to the tunnel entrance and began scooping out great chunks of juicy, golden-coloured peach. Everybody was feeling happy now.
Look, cried the centipede, just as they were finishing their meal. Look at that funny, thin, black thing gliding through the water over there.
They all swung round to look.
There are two of them, said Miss Spider.
There are lots of them, said the ladybird.
Where are they?
Asked the earthworm, getting worried.
There must be some kind of fish, said the old green grasshopper. Perhaps they've come along to say hello.
They are sharks, cried the earthworm. I'll bet you anything that they are sharks and they've come along to eat us up. I just know they're sharks.
And so, in actual fact, did everybody else, but they were too frightened
to admit it.
Just assuming there are sharks, said the centipede, there still can't be any danger if we stay up here.
But even as he spoke, one of those thin black fins suddenly changed direction and came swiftly through the water right up to the side of the beach. Slowly, the shark opened his mouth, which was big enough to have swallowed a perambulator, and made a lunge at the beach. They all watched aghast. And now, as though at a signal from the leader, all the other sharks came swimming in towards the beach and began to attack it furiously. Panic and pandemonium broke out.
Oh, we are finished now,
cried Miss Spider, wringing her feet.
They will eat up the whole peach and then they'll start on us.
Is there nothing we can do?
Asked the ladybird, appealing to James.
Surely you can think of a way out of this.
Suddenly they were all looking up at James.
Think,
begged Miss Spider.
Think, James, think.
Come on, James, said the centipede. There must be something we can do.
Their eyes waited upon him, tense, anxious, pathetically hopeful.
What can James do?
I'll tell you tomorrow. Until then, goodbye.